on a date?
Sure. Hello.
Good evening. I am Walter Blunt. I'm sure you're all aware of last night's incident when I was arrested on charges including soliciting and drunk driving.
What's going on?
I'm drinking more than I should. Recently divorced.
And what else may have contributed to last night's behavior? The ratio of cocaine to speed is just right, Major.
Peace, sir. Can I have some more?
I am trying to turn everything around. My life, my show, a mere detail, but I'd like to help save the planet.
Holy shit, Walter fucking Blunt!
Oh, shit.
No, no! Oh.
I can't keep pretending that someone is not howling in pain nearby.
Walter's manservant is leaching his body of toxins.
Very unclean!
How's it looking, Major?
Just hold still. The sun is very specific at the moment. The way that it's glinting off your bald spot, it's just like something out of the Renaissance.
Well, hello, everybody, and please welcome the cast and creative team of Blunt Talk. Hello, everyone.
Hello.
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 So we just saw the trailer for this very unique and different kind of comedy, and normally my job as a TV reporter is to try to describe to an audience what it is that you guys are trying to do with these unique and different comedies, but we are lucky enough to have the four of you here. So now is your opportunity to pitch to everyone your this very special, unique comedy, and convince them to watch it.
Well, to pitch it to you, I don't know about pitching, but what we want to do is make something that will entertain people, amuse them. This is not a dark comedy. I mean, there might be dark moments, but there's a lot of exuberance. Patrick, as Walter Blunt, has a near-death experience in which he's dancing with showgirls, like something out of a Busby Berkeley film. So there's a lot of joy in this show, as well as a lot of nuttiness and neurosis and human pain and confusion. So I don't know, is that a general pitch? Did that sound all right?
So Jonathan, why don't you tell everyone a little bit about what's going on when we meet Walter Blunt and sort of the disaster he's trying to dig himself out of?
Well, in the first episode, we find him at a bar, he's drinking heavily, and he's in a low point in his life. He's recently divorced for the fourth time. The ratings on his new show are plummeting, and he's sort of hitting bottom, and he drinks too much, then he eats some chocolate marijuana, kind of goes on an adventure, meets a beautiful sex worker, and has a very tender and loving encounter with her, but the police arrive right at the moment of great tenderness, and he gets arrested, and so he's a very much a public figure, like a Brian Williams, but now he's, you know, arrested for drunk driving, eating marijuana, having a tender moment with a lovely sex worker, and he's got to come back from this, and so that's what he tries to do in the first episode, is come back from this fall, and rise up like a phoenix, which he does over the course of the whole season. He tries to really make up, he's given a second chance, and he's a bit of a hero, a slightly lunatic hero, but he wants to do well for the American people. So the whole season is kind of a comeback from this fall in the first episode.
So Sir Patrick Stewart, doing cocaine, drunk driving, a tender encounter with a sex worker, this is not the normal role that we're used to seeing Sir Patrick Stewart perform.
Just another day.
You know, what drew you to doing something like this, which is a bit of a departure from what people are so used to seeing from you?
Seth MacFarlane's henchman hijacked me one night, tied me up, threw me in the back of a van, and I was driven out somewhere upstate, and I was kept there without food or drink for about 3 minutes until I would agree to be in his new live action comedy show Blunt Talk. So I had no choice. Okay, you want the real reason. I've been working with Seth MacFarlane for 11 years on an animated television show called American Dad, where I play Avery Bullock, the deputy director of the CIA, who is an Englishman, but the agents at the CIA are so stupid, nobody's noticed yet. Seth assures me that in the last episode, one of them will say, "Hey, have you noticed Deputy Bullock has a weird way of talking?" He approached me and said, "How would you like to do?" There was no being thrown in the back of a van or anything like that. It was actually at Bouchon Restaurant in Beverly Hills. And I said yes, and then we spent 55 minutes talking about music. And then I was introduced to Jonathan Ames, and Seth somewhat faded into the background, and we and I met and got on and talked and talked and talked and drank a lot of coffee and then a lot of other stuff, and we met like that for like 6 months, and here are 10 episodes to prove it.
Yeah, and my connection to Seth, I got an email, this being Hollywood, from an agent saying, "Would you like to get on the phone with Seth MacFarlane?" And I thought, of course I'd like to get on the phone with him. But that was one question, didn't I? I said, "What's it about?" And the agent wrote back, "He's looking for an idea for a comedy for Patrick Stewart." And so I was very intrigued. And then that night, I happened to be channel surfing, and on CNN, I saw Piers Morgan looming in front of this electric blue background. And I thought, wow, Patrick Stewart would look amazing in front of such a background, giving us the news. And I did have the thought that it would be like something out of Orwell, Patrick looming over us as a broadcaster. And so the next day I got on the phone with Seth and I said, "What about Patrick Stewart as a cable news host? And we would live, you know, but we'll live mostly behind the scenes, kind of like the old Larry Sanders show." And Seth immediately liked the idea, proposed it to Patrick. We met, and now here we are with our wonderful cast, and that's how it sort of came to be.
When you have Sir Patrick Stewart on board to do a show and you have ideas of him doing things like suckling a transsexual sex worker's breast and doing cocaine, does it excite you to have Sir Patrick Stewart do that kind of thing, or does it terrify you? What am I doing to the image of Sir Patrick Stewart by having him engage in all of these acts?
Well, I wrote that script a while ago, and you know, you write something, you don't think necessarily it's going to get made, you know, but I thought, well, I have Patrick, and you know, and I thought of the character as a hero. Patrick has played heroes, you know, the screen roles I've seen. And so then after that I began to work autobiographically, I guess, and you know, brought out situations from my own life. No, only joking. But I think it was really wonderful to visualize Patrick as Walter Blunt in these situations. But always, as scandalous as they might be, his heart is in the right place. I mean, even after doing cocaine, he's, you know, quoting Oliver Twist, you know, and Dickens. And so, you know, he's a sweet-spirited person. So these might have been dark acts, but, you know, he's bringing a sweetness into these places.
And the TV network that Walter Blunt works at is UBS, which mm-hmm. I've heard is a reference to the movie Network. What is that connection between what Walter Blunt is doing and Network as we saw decades ago?
Well, I watched Network in preparation for writing the script, and the network in the film Network is called UBS. So I thought of calling, that's why we called this UBS, as if that crazy network was still going on. And I saw Walter Blunt very much as a descendant from the character Howard Beale, and a newsman who really actually wants to deliver the news or bring the truth and is slightly losing his mind. So I kind of wanted to continue the story of Howard Beale in Blunt Talk. So that was very much a starting off point, that movie.
And Jackie, your character is a producer of Walter Blunt's show. What do you think that, you know, Blunt Talk and what he's doing is saying about news as it is right now in 2015? Because I think it does have a very interesting thing to say about media and sort of the state of things right now.
I think it's pretty accurate. I've had a bit of experience in Australia with current affairs programs, and it strikes me a lot of people who work in the news have fairly, shall we say, wild personal lives.
To say the least, I can attest to that.
I think it's such a high pressure job that people do get incredibly, tend to get terribly het up and anxious and seek some fairly out there forms of recreation. And I think in that sense it's pretty accurate, as well as being funny. I mean, it's sex and drugs and shenanigans, and it every episode has got a new foible emerge from one of the many characters. And I'm the producer, but I've got a whole staff of fascinating characters who are all very different and in some ways crazy, in other ways very endearing, and yeah.
You know, there's one episode where Patrick's character is supposed to be reporting from a hurricane in Texas and misses his flight. And instead of just not reporting from the hurricane in Texas, there's machinations of setting up a green screen and pretending that his character is actually live from Texas, which says something, I think, about the temptation to do sensationalized news, whether or not it's entirely accurate. How did you feel about things like that?
I don't want to get political. but I know that sort of thing goes on. Yeah, doing beat-ups is as old as the profession of news reporting, and it doesn't just happen in America. It happens all over the world. So, yeah, I think it's an exaggerated image of it, but it certainly happens. It's very funny that he pretends he's in the middle of a hurricane and it's a man holding a hose over him, and it's hilarious.
And looking quite cute in some rain slicks, I might add.
Oh, thank you, thank you. it's not the most glamorous outfit I've ever worn. For this, we took our cue from the world of Westminster and Washington, where these days it is so commonplace and fashionable to tell a straightforward lie and then 6 hours later withdraw it. But as you people know better than probably anyone else, it's the lie that sticks, that stays out there. Who cares about a withdrawal if the untruth has been believed? And Walter says in this scene, this green screen scene, maybe I have to lie to tell the truth.
Yeah, he wants to get out a message about what's going on with climate change, and he wants to use the hurricane as a backdrop for talking about what we're doing, you know, with the rising oceans and everything changing so rapidly. So he really wanted to cover this hurricane, but he missed the flight because he got delayed in a bathroom. He has got a lot of toilet issues, Walter, and so he got stuck in the bathroom, misses his flight. So, but still, global warming is so important that he was willing to create an illusion to try to get out a message of change, but it doesn't quite work. You know, these are heroes that quest, often fall short, but a lot of times come through. And in the midst of our comedy, though, we do try to tackle news issues. We have genital mutilation is covered. I know that sounds like a downer, but we do cover it. We have the death penalty is covered, global warming, what the internet does to the news, PTSD, pacifism, all these things do get covered in our news show amidst the comedy.
And it's amidst the comedy, as you just mentioned. And Adrian, as we saw a little bit in the trailer, you have a scene where you are spanking Sir Patrick Stewart with a towel.
Who could resist?
You're an Olivier-nominated actor. You've been in several Oscar-nominated films. How does the act of slapping the bum of Sir Patrick Stewart with a towel rank in your career?
Well, the best thing about it is that it's one of many ways in which I abuse Sir Patrick. So when I first got the script, I read a scene where we share cocaine together. And that just seemed like a lot of fun. And then... As I got given more and more scenes, it just became apparent that I couldn't possibly turn this role down because the opportunities were just too delicious and exciting. So yes, cricket bats I hit him with. I hit him with wet towels. I row him down the Venice canals singing sea shanties, and we get up to some ridiculous and wonderfully funny capers.
You're reading me bedtime stories and yes, tuck me in.
Yes. Yeah.
Can you explain what the relationship is exactly between your character and Walter Blunt?
Well, the relationship stems from their time in the military. And Harry was served under Walter in the Marines. And they had a very particular moment. You see a flashback later on in the series, which goes back to some to an incident that they had in the Falklands, which has sort of glued them together forever. And, well, certainly from Harry's perspective. So he dedicates his life to Walter and serves him in any way he possibly can, be it good, bad, or indifferent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and it's fodder for a lot of comedy. And Patrick, I know at the TCA's, the Television Critics Association panel last week, Seth MacFarlane said something along the lines of he thought of you for this because it's been a shame to waste the talents of such a great comedic actor on drama for so many years. Now, do you think it was a waste? And how do you feel about this as a spotlight for what you will all see when this premieres are some very, very serious comedic chops?
The most telling word that has been used was that this was a liberating experience, and that's how I felt it. There is a freedom about being in a drama which has the additional element of needing also to be funny. So while we're the actors and indeed the writers are asking themselves, where is the verisimilitude? Where is the truth in this? Where are the objectives? After all of that, which is standard, we ask ourselves, and where is the comedy? How is it funny? And how do we make people laugh with this? And that's proved to be, for me, I think the biggest adventure that I've had in a 54-year career. Mm.
So, as on that adventure doing this show, what was the plot line or the scene you had to shoot that maybe took you a little bit most out of your comfort zone, and you thought, "Wow, I really cannot believe that after this long the business I'm doing this right now." Maybe good or bad.
I'll be perfectly honest with you. And this is a little humiliating, but until I climbed into bed with the beautiful and brilliant Elizabeth Shue, I had never shot a post-coital scene before.
That's fascinating.
Which gives you some idea of the kind of work I've been doing. You mean, you'd think if you were playing King Claudius, at least you'd see him in bed with Gertrude. But no. So I was uncomfortable about that. I called three actress friends a couple of nights before. I don't think you know this. And one of whom was an ex-girlfriend. And I said, I need some help. Look, I'm shooting this kind of sex scene tomorrow with someone I have yet to meet, but whom I have a great crush on and a big admiration for. I mean, how far do I go? What will she be expecting of me? I mean, is it just a closed-lip kiss? Is there any tongue? I was asking them all these questions. Would that be appropriate with somebody you've just met? I mean, what if I had a caress of one of her breasts? Am I going to get slapped in the face and a lawsuit brought against me? And so all of them gave me their advice about this and said, no, you're worried too much, far too much about this. Two of the three said to me, try to make it amusing if you can, and that will relax everybody. And that's what I did, and the end result was what you've seen.
Well, it's a very playful love scene, and they're very close. Whenever I see the actors like that, I'm like, I wonder if they've loaded up on mints. I have the same kind of neurotic worries in a codependent way. I'm like, I hope Patrick had a lot of mints and not too much garlic at lunch, because they were right on top of each other. And your hand was in her hair. And another love scene, there was a lot of grabbing going on between you and Sharon Lawrence. And I'd be at the monitor going, oh my God, but they're really both getting into it. Patrick had two nice makeout scenes. But after the Elizabeth Shue scene, he came off of the bed and he said, that was my first post-coital scene. And we're like, wow, that, because he was completely natural. You know, they were kissing a lot. It was wonderful. So you couldn't have, we could not tell at the monitor that this was a first for him.
Are you suggesting that Sir Patrick Stewart's a good actor?
I just say, let me reassure you that it was not actually the first post-coital experience.
This is taking a very interesting turn.
It's awkward, you know. I really should have asked guys, shouldn't I? I should have asked Adrian here what it's like. I'm sure he's done it many times.
You know,
you saw most of it today on that.
Yes, I did, yeah.
Yeah, at one point, things are getting very frisky in the Blunt Talk office, and there's a lot of copulating happening behind closed doors, and Walter, as the head of, you know, the team, says, listen, enough sex during working hours, you know. There are other ways to relieve stress. I mean, it's a very permissive show. The characters are very permissive. And so one of the characters, you know, what falls under sex? And, you know, someone asks maybe about touching oneself. Walter says, not during working hours. Rosalie asks about cuddling and affection because she likes to spoon people to relax them. And then finally, Harry says,
what about towel whipping, Major?
And then Walter says, that's not sexual, Harry. And Harry goes, it's not. Sorry, I said your line, Harry. I apologize.
Did it better than me.
Well, as we're all pointing out, this is it's a really fun show. It's also a very weird and non-traditional show. Certainly not a show that you would see on NBC, Fox, CBS, or a broadcast network. And, you know, Jonathan, you've done Bored to Death. You have this show that's coming out. And, you know, I look at the landscape of TV now, and I wonder, as someone who's in the business, whether you feel like it's becoming more hospitable for things that are a little more offbeat and a little weirder and, you know, a little more, therefore, interesting.
Well, I think for a while now, television has probably eclipsed, with everyone having these beautiful HD TVs, the movies that used to be made for $10 or $15 million, which aren't getting made as much, are being, you know, really made on TV, and people are having almost a cinematic experience at home. So these, what, you know, we of course still have independent films, but there's just so much more of that kind of quality of material being done on television now as the movie theater sort of goes the way of the bookstore. So I think that television, obviously, you know, since the 90s with HBO, has really become some of the best source of, you know, very human characters. And so that's, you know, with Blunt Talk, I really feel like I'm getting, not on that level, but getting to make the kind of movies that Woody Allen was making in the 70s or early 80s or to this day, actually. But, you know, that kind of material, which you don't find as much in the cinema, is now happening on television. Mm-hmm.
And Jackie, after your Oscar nomination for Animal Kingdom,
you were right.
Everything okay? So after your Oscar nomination for Animal Kingdom, I feel
it was just
like
the mention of an Oscar. That's all.
So after that thing that we won't mention for Animal Kingdom, you have two of them. Your career exploded, especially in movies, and I'm curious, what was it about a show like this that drew your attention and sort of got you to commit to making the leap to a regular small screen series?
I have to be honest, it was meeting Jonathan Ames and subsequently reading a couple of his novels and a couple of his other books. And seeing Bored to Death too, which was Jonathan's other TV series with the wonderful Jason Schwartzman, who does a beautiful cameo in Blunt Talk. And just the way Jonathan described the show and what it was going to be like and what my character was going to be and that Patrick was going to do it, I just thought it was an absolute yes right from the beginning.
And now you can say that you have spooned Patrick Stewart.
I can say that, and I often say that.
Before we turn it over to audience questions, I'm just curious if everyone could share maybe something that surprised them most about working with a knighted actor. It's particularly this one.
Surprised us the most. Who wants to go first, anyone? Well, let's see, I'll go first. I just love how open Patrick was to everything. You know, when he got whipped, he's howling in pain. When he's with, you know, having this tender scene in a car before the cops arrive, he's just incredibly kind and loving. I mean, he just brought so many, like a spectrum of feelings and emotions to every scene and incredible consistency. I wouldn't say surprised, but just delighted day after day sitting at the monitor watching the work that he did and that everyone did. So I don't know if it's so much surprise, but also then things happening that you didn't expect, like the towel whipping, you know, and the rapport they had. Clearly, in a past life, Adrian had whipped Patrick once before in a somewhat erotic way. So there was all sorts of gems like that.
Adrian?
Well, I don't know where life? That leaves me to go, really. His work ethic is alarming. I mean, he's just, he doesn't stop. And you're slightly older than me by probably 6 months or so. And you, no?
Much.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Yes, he's the hardest working man in showbiz, frankly.
Yeah, I was going to say that. You took the words out of my mouth. I think he, I don't want to embarrass you because I know I did this.
Go
morning.
On, force yourself.
I know I did this morning.
Go on, go on!
But I think the way Patrick arrives on set, he's so enthusiastic, he works so hard, he never complains, he's sweet, humble, he's fabulous. And I think he's such an example to young actors. I wish some young actors just were made to follow him around and follow his example, because this is the way to behave. Know your lines, be punctual, and stay cheerful. I just want to say one more thing that I'm sure this audience will understand. Until I did this show, I did not know what motorboating was. And it's not, neither did Jonathan. It wasn't in the script. Well, it was, but I'm from a generation, it's not that we never did it, we just didn't know it had a name. And the way I found out the word, I get my call sheet for the next day's shooting and it says, Jackie gets motorboated. And I said to I don't remember a scene on the beach. I said to some young member of the crew, what's motorboating? Well, they shrieked. Anyway, I hope I haven't given too much away. I do get motorboated.
More than once.
More than once. By a young man of 24.
Well, I think now is a good time to open up to audience questions about Blunt Talk, Jackie's history with motorboating, any of the above.
How is Blunt Talk different from any other project you have participated in?
Anybody? Adrian?
Oh. The budget was quite. This is the first time that I've ever worked in America, and it's. I've done a lot of quite low budget work in the UK, and it's really, really lovely to have an amount of money which allows you to make something and make it really, really well, keeping everybody happy, and giving everybody the opportunity to be as creative as they possibly can be. And that has been utterly enthralling because we're constantly in the UK up against it. And it was really, really lovely to come here and do something where the creative process was given all the time and all of the energy that it required to make something really, really wonderful and special. Glorious and enthralling to be a part of.
What was different for me, my previous show was set in New York and Brooklyn, and I set the show in LA because I felt I had filmed so much in New York, and I kind of wanted to find a new environment. And so about 2 days out of a 6-day shooting schedule, we can go outside in LA. And so I really wanted to find beautiful locations. So we shot out in the desert, you know, did these beautiful, something like out of Paris, Texas, that film. We shot in the Venice canals. We went to the top of one of the mountains in Griffith Park, overlooking the whole city. We shot in Hollywood. So I really wanted, with this show, to kind of capture some of the beauty of LA. Because in my previous show, I so much highlighted Brooklyn and Manhattan. So this was different for me, was to kind of have fun running around looking for beautiful images in Los Angeles.
Patrick?
Well, we've talked about the my newness to comedy, and I am surrounded by people who are very, very experienced in comedy. I just wanted to, and comedians have been my heroes all my life. The first movie stars I worshipped were Oliver Hardy and Stan Laurel, partly because I have a family connection with Stan, but because I believed everything they did. They were always desperately serious about what they were doing and somehow managed to make that seriousness, that desperation, comic. And I think, you know, when we speak about the liberty that we have, certainly with cable shows these days, I think we have to thank stand-up a great deal for that. That in the last 15, 20 years, it has been Chris Rock and Louis C.K. and Amy Poehler who have really pushed the boundaries of what you can talk about and make it funny. I mean, there's hardly an area now that these and other comedians have not trampled on. And I think it has all been able to filter over into television, drama, and comedy too. Would you say that's right?
I think so. And just mentioning Laurel and Hardy, though, one of the things I wanted to do in the show sometimes was to recreate certain moments in cinema. And so we recreate pay homage to a very famous Laurel and Hardy film, The Music Box, and which shows Laurel and Hardy trying to push a piano or carry a piano up a large staircase, and then it keeps sliding back down. So Harry and Walter deliver a piano on a very similar staircase. I wanted to shoot at the actual staircase, but it wasn't as easy to shoot there. So LA has all these beautiful staircases from the 1920s when there were trolley cars, and the trolley cars would drop people off at the bottom of these staircases. Not everyone had automobiles, and they would walk up these enormous flights of stairs. And they're kind of hidden now and overgrown, but I really love them. And so we shot in one of them. And recently, I, as a way to chastise myself, actually, I've been running up and down these staircases as a sort of spiritual test. A complete tangent, but I mention it.
So. The next question.
Patrick, I love your Twitter account. If Walter Blunt were to have a Twitter account, would it look like something like yours? And are you going to create one?
Is this the moment? Walter does have a Twitter account. He's actually had it. I opened it about over a year ago. But it's dormant. It will not be dormant much longer. Walter is going to be tweeting to the world with a little help from his friends. And I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to having a mouthpiece that is not Patrick Stewart's mouth, so that the things that I might be able to say might be a little bit more extreme.
Next question.
Hi, my name is Dave. I'm a big fan.
Hi.
I'm excited for the show. This question is for Jackie. I first saw you in the film Cozy many years back, a wonderful film, and have enjoyed watching you gain a lot of exposure here in the U.S. How does that feel as an actress, as you said, of a slightly older generation?
Slightly.
gaining such a foothold in an industry that is so focused on youth so often.
Well, it took me completely by surprise. America was never on my agenda. I just was extremely lucky. I'd been perfectly content with my career in Australia. I did a lot of theatre. I've been in about 100 plays. I've done a lot of television, both drama and comedy. I had 2 TV series that were written especially for me, and I'd made about, 20 films in Australia, and suddenly a little independent film that we made in Australia got picked up at Sundance, and the rest for me was history. And that was 4.5 years ago, and since then I've worked on 15 films in America and 2 TV series. And I just recently did a film in Australia, and it was the first time I'd used my Australian accent for 4 years, and the crew were terrible, I have to tell you. They teased me endlessly. You sound American. What are you sounding American for? So, does that answer the question?
Next question.
It's going to be our last question.
Sir Patrick, I read a couple of weeks ago that you met up with Piers Morgan about this role. Could you talk a little bit about that conversation, and does he believe that this character is a direct representation of Piers at all?
Our first ever encounter was when I was having breakfast in a very fancy hotel in Beverly Hills, and I suddenly heard a voice in the dining room saying, "Patrick Stewart, you're playing me. What are you up to?" And so I went over and reassured him briefly that I wasn't playing him, that his lawyers could stand down, there would be no lawsuit. And I liked him. He was very pleasant. So we arranged to meet for breakfast the next morning. And as a result of that meeting, he filled me in on the background of being an English media person, a journalist, working on a nightly American TV news show. And it was invaluable insight, but also instructive too, in that he told me those areas that he had found most difficult and the ones that he had enjoyed most. But I was lucky to spend 2 days, one day on The Daily Show with Jon Stewart, who I knew somewhat from having been on the show, from the first production meeting at 8:30 in the morning until the post-mortem after the recording of the show that night. And to my delight, Rachel Maddow also agreed that I could be a fly on the wall. And I was so impressed by her coolness, her intellect, not just intelligence, intellect, and her skill on camera, and the profound seriousness with which she approached everything. I'm still hoping that at some point we might have John and Pierce. Certainly, Pierce on the show would be high entertainment, I feel, and Rachel too, because she's so fabulous.
All right, well, thank you all for coming, and please make sure to mark your calendars for August 22nd on Stars and tune in for the premiere of Blunt Talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.